gives you the solution to the problems of humankind. Not that you shall despise each other.
That according to Japan, India will be the superpower of the world.
We will be a superpower, will be far superior to the Americans.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل إلى صبر ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادل بالتي أحسن رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي Now welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. You are most welcome to ask any questions on Islam and compassion religion of any question which a non-Muslim may have posed to you and you are unable to reply, this is the opportunity. So the question they are most welcome, brothers and sisters. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Mera sawal ye hai ke aap sallallahu alaihi wasallam jab hayat the to sahaba-e-karam aap sallallahu alaihi wasallam ko kis tarike se pukarte the aur sahaba-e-karam aapas mein ek dusre ko kis tarike se pukarte the kya wo ek dusre ko raziyallahu anhum kehte the.
The brother asked a question that how did they address Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Did they say that may peace and mercy be upon him? Did they say Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And when the Sahabas, when the companions of the Prophet spoke with each other, how did they address themselves? Previously, they called him by name and called him the way they wanted to give respect, each one. But the moment the verse was revealed of the Quran, Surah Azab, chapter number 33, verse number 56, after this, when the commandment came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the angels send blessings to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and anyone send blessings, after this stage, everyone did the same thing. Similarly, there are hadith saying that we should send blessings on the Sahabas. So moment when this juncture came, after that, the way they addressed was that. Before that, everyone addressed the way they felt was with respect. But once the revelation came, then it became unified. Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.
Just because this was a different topic, that's why I couldn't tell this thing. But I'm coming back to the first topic. That he said it was revealed in another prophet will be coming back and he will be speak whatever he speaks in the name of Allah. It is Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. But in many cases I have seen, in many places I have seen, that even the surahs which are having Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim in the time of the salah, the prayers, that time, they don't say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So what does that this thing? Then when he, it is already mentioned that it will be said in whatever he will speak will be spoken in the name of Allah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. He will be there, but there are some imams also they don't say this Bismillahir.
Brother asked the question that the various prophets of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whenever he comes he will speak in the name of Allah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and this prophecy has been given in various scriptures, including in the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, Old Testament, book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18, says, all that he hears from Almighty God shall he speak, he will not speak of himself. That means it will be a wahi, it will be a revelation. Fine? I mean, whatever will be revealed to him, he will speak. That's point number one. Secondly, even if you agree that whatever he will say in the name of Allah, so every chapter starts with Bismillah and Manarim. If you analyze that the whole Quran, it is a wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Besides the wahi, every chapter except for Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, starts with Bismillah and Manarim. Many people say that 8th and 9th is continuation, whatever it is. So here we realize that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is there in the beginning of every surah. The full Quran contains 114 Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now we realize that every surah does contain. But in the salah, it's not required that we start from the starting of the surah. The requirement of salah is different and what was revealed is different. The requirement of salah is that you can recite after Surah Fatiha any one long verse of the Quran or three short verses. This is the requirement. And before Surah Fatiha, everyone does say Bismillah Rahman Rahim. Different opinion, you can say loudly, you can say softly in your heart. But Bismillah is said. Whether to say loudly or softly in your heart is different opinion. But Bismillah has to be said. There's no two doubt about it. Right? So this is a different opinion. So whether you want to say it loudly or softly, many times when you go into ruku, we say softly. You go into sujood, we say softly. So similar Bismillah, different opinion is there because hadiths are there, Sahih hadith, saying both things. Prophet sometimes said loudly before Surah Fatiha Bismillah, sometimes softly. So both are valid. So even in a salah, we do say Bismillah Rahman Rahim. But what you're talking about, the prophecy is talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is talking that he will not speak of himself. Whatever he hears, will he speak. Whatever is revealed to him, he will speak. And whenever any surah started, it started with Sunnah mind. Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My question is, in some masjids, so while they are praying, they switch off the mics by saying that the imam has to say it should not be heard by any other media. We have to hear it from only from the imam. And especially in Jummah, Friday prayer, that two khutbas which we say before the salam. So it says that also stands the value of two rakats. So at that time they are not switch off the mics. So can you tell me why do they make that?
That's a good question. That why do in some mosques they switch off the mics for Jummah Salah? And the reason they say this is because Muhammad Salah never used the mic. Because Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did not use a mic for Salah, therefore for us to use is wrong. This is the view of a small group of Muslims. But majority of the mosques will find that microphone is there. So because it is not part of Ibadah, saying on the mic is not part of Ibadah, so I feel there's no problem if you say on the mic. Prophet Muhammad never gave a lecture on the microphone I'm giving. Fine, so there's no problem at all. So this is the view of some of the Muslims. And the counter argument to give is very nice, that in the Jummah Salah, when the khutbah has got two rakat value. So why do they say the khutbah on the mic? That have to ask them, not me. Because I believe that even if you say the salah on the microphone, it's perfectly valid. There's no problem. If you're saying in a small group, where the voice can reach the last line, just but normally, so microphone is not required. But if you're saying in a big gathering where thousands of people are there, so mic is preferable. At least the last row can hear and they can follow. Previously, what used to happen that when a person used to say any takbir, when the last person couldn't hear, then someone down the line, after 10 rows, 15 rows, 20 rows, to repeat. So by the time it reached the last line, it would take a few seconds. But now when technology has improved, so previously Prophet used to go to Hajj. All the people at the time of the Prophet, Sahaba, they went either on the camel or walking. So do we also have to go to Hajj walking on the camel? We can go, not that we can't go. But it may take months for us to reach there. So today we're using the aeroplane. Fine. In the main act of Hajj, it should be followed the way it is done. So here we realize that I have got no objection in people using the microphone in the Salah. But there are some people who object. So we have to ask them, why do they don't in the Salah but in the Khutbah? Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
In the Bible, right from Adam alayhi salam, their descendant and name of the prophets are given in their age they lived. So, is it right?
Brother asked the question that in the Bible, the names of the prophets are given and the descendants are given and the age is given. Is it right? As far as anything in the Bible is mentioned, we have to use the rule of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the Hadith of Sahih Bukhari that whatever you quote from the books of the Ahl-e Kitab, if it's right, there is no problem. So, the rule that has been devised is that if anything mentioned in any other scripture, mainly the Ahl-e Kitab, but I put it forward in any other scripture of the non-Muslims. If it matches with the Quran, we have no objection in accepting it and we have to accept it. That this is the right portion. Anything which contradicts the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, we have to reject it. Anything which we find in the non-Muslim scriptures, including the Bible and the Christian and the Jew scriptures, if it matches with the Quran and Sahih Hadith, we say it is right, we have no objection in accepting that portion to be the word of God. If it contradicts the Quran and Sahih Hadith, we reject it, saying it is wrong. Even if they may claim it to be the word of God. Now that portion which does not contradict, neither agrees with the Quran or Sahih Hadith, goes in the ambiguous plot. May be right, may be wrong, but we can't use that as a hujjah. Hujjah means as a proof. But we can say maybe it is that, maybe it is not. But many of the commentators, unfortunately, of the Quran, they use these ambiguous portions and they give commentary as though it is part of a deen which is wrong. What agrees Quran says this we accept, or they should mention in the commentary, this is what the Bible says, it may be right, may be wrong. But what the Bible says, if it doesn't contradict the Quran, you can use it as a source of information but not as a proof that this is exactly what happened. And for us it makes no difference in a iman. What difference does it make in the age of the person whether he lived for 50 years or 60 years? What difference is the last and final message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? We have to follow his guidance, that's important. But for comparative studies or for knowledge, you read, no problem, but you can't use that as a hujjah. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Is handwriting reading is allowed in Islam? Though they are telling like, oh, we just characterize you, we are not telling your future and all.
Sister is saying that, is reading of handwriting allowed in Islam? We aren't talking about the future, but about a character. As long as it is not talking about the future of the person, it is not haram. But reading a character of a person by handwriting, per se I wouldn't say haram, but can lead to problems. Well, how authentic it is a different question. I've met some of these specialists, but I don't think everything is authentic. So someone, suppose a doctor says, the way a person walks, I can tell about disease, yes, that's allowed. The way the person comes and sits, medical doctor within the profession will tell about the diseases. So that is where the nature of his walk. So this is not haram. Similarly, there is some science talking about the nature of a person, it's not wrong, but if it is just ambiguous and trying to pull a fast one, you have to abstain from it. So as far as handwriting, I know that they don't talk about the future, but they talk about the nature. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Is handwriting reading is allowed in Islam? Though they are telling like, oh, we just characterize you, we are not telling your future and all.
Sister is saying that, is reading of handwriting allowed in Islam? We aren't talking about the future, but about a character. As long as it is not talking about the future of the person, it is not haram. But reading a character of a person by handwriting, per se I wouldn't say haram, but can lead to problems. Because how authentic it is a different question. I've met some of these specialists, but I don't think everything is authentic. So someone, suppose a doctor says, the way a person walks, I can tell about disease, yes, that's allowed. The way the person comes and sits, medical doctor within the profession will tell about the diseases. So that is where the nature of his walk. So this is not haram. Similarly, there is some science talking about the nature of a person. It's not wrong, but if it is just ambiguous and trying to pull a fast one, you have to abstain from it. So as far as handwriting, I know that they don't talk about the future, but they talk about the nature. But what they say, that if you change your handwriting, even your nature will change. They go a step forward. I said, that is great. So then we have to keep all the Quran aside, huh? And only try and practice about handwriting. If you're straight handwriting, whatever, I don't know the exact rules, straight handwriting, honest. Sleeping handwriting, this one. So then why should I give lectures? I'll say, okay, only straight handwriting. So why should we want them if you want to go to Jannah? So this I don't agree. Partly something may be true, but if they say that, so I'm saying that, I mean, then you would become great people. So why you have to go to all the lectures and the schools, etc., you know? Fine. So what they say, something, if you like that, then you become rude. If your handwriting is round, it becomes this and that. And it may match here or there somewhat. But then saying that your nature changes by changing your handwriting, I disagree. So surely this can lead to things which are wrong. But per se, analyzing, I wouldn't say haram, but it leads to things which may go to haram later on. Therefore, abstaining is the best sister. Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I'd like to know, what is your view on Islamic banking nowadays? Is people, many banks like HSB, Amna, and there are other institutions which support that we are into Islamic banking and loaning. So how halal it is to take a loan from them?
Brother, there's a question that, what are my views on Islamic banking? Many banks have come up, HSBC has come up. We know as a general policy, as a general rule, that conventional bank, we deal with riba, deal with interest is haram. Personally, I won't speak on that. But regarding question, the Islamic bank that have cropped up, how Islamic are they? Tell you frankly, because of the system that we are, I don't know of any bank which is 100% Islamic. I don't know of any bank which is 100% Islamic. But some banks are more Islamic than the others. So you may have to do a particular survey on that. But today, there are various options that are given in Islamic banking. Musharika is there, then Murahaba is there, then Ijara is there. As far as Musharika, partnership is not no problem. As far as the system of cost plus Murahaba is concerned, there is a difference of opinion. In other aspects, Ijara, hire purchase, and partnership, profit and loss sharing, there is not much controversy on that. The major controversy we have today is on system of cost plus, where even I differ. I don't agree with most of the system of cost plus.
And most of the Islamic banks, not all, the majority of the dealing is cost plus. If you go to the Hadith and the Quran, it hasn't defined how it has to be. Yeah, the basic guidelines are there. Interest is haram, riba is haram, profit loss sharing allowed. So on these basic guidelines, musharika, profit and loss sharing, all this is fine. But where cost plus comes, there's a question. So when you do cost plus and you try to compete with a conventional bank, you trap and ending in something like riba, but only catching the nose in a different way. So therefore the strict scholars, they say the cost plus muraba that is there, it is dangerous. Some say it's haram. Some say some are haram. Some say majority are haram. So I would say, according to me, majority are haram. So you have to scrutinize each case. So I can't give a fatwa on any particular bank per se. And I've spoken to many people running banks. And they find me too strict. They say, oh, Zakir is a fanatic. I said, yes, as far as riba is concerned, I'm totally against it. It is one of the biggest sins. And Hadith says that there are 70 levels. In riba, the lowest level is doing zina with your mother. So it is more bad than dealing with alcohol, dealing with drugs, etc., according to me. Therefore, if you work in an alcohol company, according to me, or in a drug company, cocaine company, it's a lesser sin than working in a bank. People say, oh, Zakir is too strict. I said, this is what I am, according to the Quran. Because having alcohol is haram, having drugs is haram. It's a big sin. But Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 278, 279, that if you give up not the demands of riba, Allah and His Rasul will wage a war against you. So, this is the biggest sin even than alcohol and drugs. Therefore, I say don't keep your money even in a fixed deposit or saving account and give in charity, even that's haram. Why? Because first you have to take and then give it to someone. Quran says, taking only is haram. To give first you have to take. The moment you open a savings account or fixed deposit, you are signing and giving them permission to use your money on riba. So better than that, you invest your money in alcohol company or drug company, cocaine. Whatever profit you have given charity, you'll do less sin. I'm not saying that's allowed, no? Brother said that most of the salaries get carried into savings account. Most. So why are you involved in most? Most of the people are doing shirk. You say, I want a current account. Tell to your company that open a current account. Now open a current account. Previously it was difficult, not that impossible. Now you get zero balance current account. Zero balance also. You know, put your foot down. But the bank does not like giving current account because they cannot use your money. If you give fixed deposit, 100% money they can use for a bar. Savings account, majority. Current account, they cannot, but yet they do. But very little. So why do they force you to give fixed deposit? When they give a fixed deposit, they're giving you 7%, 8% interest in India. Other places 6%, some place 5%. That means they should say they don't put because they're losing money. The reason is because there are laws governing the bank. In fixed deposit, they can use 100% of your money. And when you sign, you're giving them permission. In savings account, they can use part, most of the majority. In current, they cannot, but yet they do use, not that they don't. So, but you aren't giving them authority to use. You are giving current account only facilitating your service. So therefore, best option is current account. If you have to keep money, otherwise don't keep in the bank only. Keep current account. So your salary also, you can't say that the company forcing you. Tell to the company, I want current account. It's not allowed in my religion. Simple. Open a current account. Fine. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Brother, Assalamu Alaikum.
I
just wanted to question you. Suppose a non-Muslim dies, are Muslims allowed to go for the funeral?
The sister has a question that if a non-Muslim dies, are Muslims allowed to go for the funeral? Going, I would say, is not haram. What you do is important. Because there are various verses in the Quran that once a person dies as a mushrik, you cannot pray for his maghfirat. Cannot pray to Allah that may he go in Jannah or may he be forgiven. Right? But if you go for condolence of the family, if you think you can do dawah, there's no problem. There are hadith saying that when there was a funeral passing and the Prophet stood up, the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, he's a Jew. The Prophet said, isn't he a human being? That means the Prophet gave respect that even though dead body stood up. So that way per se proves that going for condolence is no problem. But praying that may his soul rest in peace, or may he go to Jannah, may his sins be forgiven, that's not allowed. You can go there, if you feel you can console. If you feel that it's difficult for you to do all this, avoid. If you feel you can go and give a condolence to the non-Muslim parents or family members of the person deceased, no problem. But see to it you don't do any act which is haram, prohibited in Islam. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa barakatuh.
I wanted to ask you, say I am good Muslim. And I am practicing. No, I mean, like, if a person is good Muslim and he's practicing, like, at least the least requirements, but he does not do da'wah or preachings. Maybe a couple of times he may say something to his friends or something like that, but except time he didn't give. So does that affect me in any way in the day of judgment or my encounter?
But I ask the question that if a person is a good Muslim, practicing Muslim, but does not do da'wah. You are saying good practicing Muslim but not da'wah is contradicting. A practicing Muslim has to do da'wah. Good Muslim but does not pray Salah. So good Muslim will pray Salah. Anyhow, there is a good Muslim who does everything required except da'wah. You can ask the question that he offers Salah, he has gone for Hajj, he has kept his fasting, does not tell lies, but does not do da'wah. So everything what is required does but not da'wah, will he go to Jannah? That's the question. According to Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 4, it says, Wal asr innal insana lafi khusr. Which means that by the token of time, man is verily in loss. Man is in khasara. Except those are four things. Iman, he should have righteous deeds. Watawasaw bil haq, inviting people to truth, that is dawah. And watawasaw bil sabr, inviting and exhorting people to patience and perseverance. So for going to Jannah, all four things are equally important. If anyone is missing, under normal circumstances, you shall not go to Jannah. You may be a very good Muslim, you may be offering five times Salah, you may have gone for Hajj, you may be fasting in the month of Ramadan, may have paid the zakat, may be working hard, but don't do da'wah. According to Surah Al-Asr, you shall not go to Jannah. If Allah wants to forgive you and put you in Jannah, that's Allah's prerogative. He can do that. Because Allah says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 48, and in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 116, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He pleases, He may forgive any sin, but will not forgive the sin of shirk. So shirk, associating partners with God, worshipping anyone besides Almighty God, this Allah will never forgive. Anything else, if He pleases, He may forgive. So if you don't do da'wah and Allah wants to forgive you, He can. If you don't fast and Allah wants to forgive you, He can. But will Allah forgive? I don't know. So best is do everything. That is the best. Once in a blue moon doing da'wah, you should do regularly. Once in a blue moon you don't do, then you'll be forgiven, inshallah. Fine. But once in a blue moon you do, once in a year, no. You have to do da'wah. In whatever best way you can. It's not necessary you have to give public lectures. Not necessary you have to have whole meetings. Talk to your friends. Can't talk directly, give books. Give video cassettes. The best of your ability. Fine. You can use your money to get some books, whatever it is. So whatever is in your capacity, you should try and convey the message. To the best of ability. It's a requirement, it's a fard. It's one of the requirements to go to Jannah. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillah bil alamin.
Ya Rabbu innaka antas salam minka salam ilayka salam. Ya Rabbu innaka antas salam minka salam ilayka salam. Li amrika yarji'u amrul anam. بين يديك قلوب الأنام لأمرك يرجع أمر الأنام بين يديك قلوب الأنام